Distinguished Professor Ignacio Sanchez, Principal of the University. Distinguished Professor Carlos Frontaura, Dean of the School of Law. Distinguished Professor Maria Elena Pimstein, Secretary General of the University. Distinguished Professor Ricardo Irarrázaval, Vice Dean of the School of Law. Distinguished Professor Alejandra Ovalle, Academic Associate Dean of the School of Law. Distinguished authorities, dear colleagues and students, ladies and gentlemen, it is a great honor for me to be here and to be asked at the start of your academic year to give an inaugural lecture. It is almost 5 years ago that I visited your wonderful Faculty of Law for the first time. I have a great admiration for the high quality of your teaching and scholarship, and I strongly believe in the need for a deeper cooperation between the Chilean universities and European universities. In fact, over the last Easter weekend, I have just finished a study for the European Parliament in which we make recommendations for a deeper partnership between Latin America and the European Union. I will not speak about that today. I will speak about our life in interesting times. You may know that this is a hint to an old Chinese saying, of which I am not sure whether it is meant as a compliment or as a kind of curse. Because we do live indeed in interesting times. The acceleration, the intensification of international exchanges in these days of ongoing globalization, they are just omnipresent. And we often hear about globalization in economic terms, with a focus on increased cross-border trade in goods and services, the unprecedented mobility of capital, of investments, of ideas across the globe. And this is, of course, the most visible, tangible kind of manifestation of globalization. But there is a less visible side to globalization, which has to do with its impacts upon our culture, upon our language, upon our thinking, our social behavior, our ethics. And I think also in a very subtle way, there is an interaction between globalization and the evolution of our legal systems, domestic legal systems, and international legal systems. In our legal scholarship, we are only slowly picking up and trying to assess the impact of globalization. And that is what I would try to do a little bit now today with you. I would like to go with you in a number of reflections about the impact of globalization upon public international law. My main thesis is that traditional public international law has not yet been able to fully capture all new dynamics of globalization, both in terms of new forms of norms and regulations, standardizations, but also in terms of the new actors that have come up in international relations. It seems that, as my Finnish, in fact Dutch, colleague Jan Klabbers has said, you notice he has the same first name as I have, globalization seems to have bypassed the discipline of international law almost completely. And I think it's time we address this. So I will first say you a little bit about traditional public international law and what I perceive as its main shortcomings. Then we will go into a relatively new phenomenon, the rise of informal international lawmaking, all kinds of standards which you cannot fit in the traditional categories of public international law, but which are important. Then we will have some reflections upon what we call the slowdown in the current traditional forms of international lawmaking. You may be surprised to hear that, in fact, today we are making less treaties than we used to make 20 years ago. There is something happening there. in the preferences, in the behavior of states, in the work of international organizations. And we're going to address that quickly here. Obviously, when you speak about public international law, you cannot be silent about customary international law. How does customary law evolve in a time of globalization? And then last but not least, global governance. There is a new form of scholarship, interdisciplinary, not strictly legal, but which is, I think, refreshing to better understand certain dynamics of globalization. And I will conclude, if I may, with some reflections on how we can bring public international law better into the 21st century. But I will start with some reflections on what I see as shortcomings of the traditional public international law. I know there are many learned colleagues here who teach international law, and I'm sure you have the same experience. I have been teaching it for 20 years now at the Catholic University of Leuven, and more I felt that there are some tensions between what we write in our handbooks, in our textbooks, what we teach our students, and what is out there in the real life. And to be honest, we need to cope with the real life. We cannot just cope with law in the books. And that manifests itself in many respects, but I will just choose two subject matters, the so-called sources and the subjects of international law. Two classical doctrines which everybody who teaches and who studies international law has, of course, to cope with. First of all, sources of international law. And here we mean, of course, the ways in which rules of public international law come about. As you may know, there is a kind of overview of, or a list of classical sources, methods for establishing international norms, in a famous Article 38 of the Statute of the International Court of Justice. It's an old article, it dates from 1920, and it shows a little bit that it is old. But it is still there, it is still the applicable law. And as you see, I mention it here on the slide, it basically lists a number of sources of international law that the International Court of Justice has to use, but which we always start our courses with. Treaties, meaning conventions, customary international law, general principles of law, the judicial decisions and the teachings of the most highly qualified publicists of the various nations, and then a number of other things such as equity. And I will come back to that, but what I want to show you is that this article, which we are still using in our classes, is highly imperfect. It dates from nearly a century ago. And it is still a useful starting point for teaching the ABC of international law. And of course, treaties and customary law are still the main sources of public international law. Although I will come back to this and will show you that the preeminence of both treaties and customary law are a little bit, for the moment, on the decline. I think there are many shortcomings. Read with me the reference to general principles of law as recognized by civilized nations. Nowadays, can we still use that language? Civilized versus uncivilized nations. It looks a little bit politically incorrect. A similar ambiguity, judicial decisions. What does this mean? National courts, international courts? There are many international tribunals out there. There were almost none back in 1920. Teachings of the most highly qualified publicists of the various nations. The dean has mentioned a number of those publicists. But we don't live anymore in the times of Grotius. We live, of course, in a time of mass academic literature production. So I invite you to say, who can say which publicists these are? And what is their legitimacy to give normative orientations for the international community today? And Article 38 is also incomplete. It does not mention certain very important sources. Equity. It does not mention unilateral acts of states or of international organizations. It does not mention jus cogens. soft law. It does not mention a hierarchy between the norms. And very importantly, I think, it does not take into account at all the question of democratic legitimacy, or the lack of democratic legitimacy in the way in which international norms come about. This is an important topic. In Europe, we have done many research projects about the question to what extent international normative activity of all kinds of international organizations threaten the rule of law and the domestic democratic processes in countries. It's a relevant topic. And we have to ask ourselves the question, indeed, is international lawmaking legitimate? Is it sufficiently democratically legitimized? Is there accountability for the lawmaking? Is there enough transparency? And so on. All questions which Article 38 does, of course, not address, but we have to remember it was written for a time that there was a largely anarchic international society. Does that still fill the needs of the 21st century? Big question mark. So that's the very first imperfection that I see. There is another area, the subjects of international law, which we teach to our students, and which, of course, deals with the actors, the relevant actors in the international legal system. Until today, states are still seen to be the primary main subjects of international law. And quite, you know, understandably so. It is states who still enjoy the fullest sets of international rights and obligations. They have the total toolkit at their disposal for implementing and enforcing all kinds of rights and duties. A long time ago, it was just states. States had a monopoly on international law. This has changed. This has changed in the course of the 20th century, and there I think we should give credit to a very open-minded attitude of the International Court of Justice. And I give you a citation here from a very famous advisory opinion rendered in 1949. It is the case of reparation for injuries, in which the International Court of Justice indeed recognized that being a subject of international law is not necessarily reserved to being a state. It basically says that subjects of a legal system are not necessarily identical in their nature and in the extent of their rights. And very importantly, that all of this depends on the needs of the community. This is a very open case. It really shows how the International Court of Justice was willing to look at the dynamics of international relations and to recognize that apart from states, new actors were coming up, in that particular case, the United Nations. 1949, it was long before many other organizations were set up. It was quite a few years before we saw the origins of most regional and sub-regional organizations, of which also Latin America is a very fertile ground. So I think that this case still needs to be applied, and we need to wonder indeed which other actors are nowadays to be considered as relevant subjects of international law. And there again, there may be some openness thanks to this case, but the system is still very states-dominated. And to be honest, states don't have a real interest to accept many other rivals in the international legal system. So the states are there, and they continue to dominate the scene for themselves. And I think, yes, the system still accepts that states are the primary subjects, and if we are recognizing other subjects to some extent, like multinational enterprises or non-governmental organizations, or even individuals in the area of international criminal law and human rights law, we always recognize them only as some kind of derived subjects. They are secondary, because they first need to be recognized as actors by the states. States enjoy these plenary powers. International organizations only have the powers that were conferred upon them. And all these kinds of other things that we teach are students. I think that this form of teaching too needs to be revisited in light of the enormous proliferation of normative processes that are not simply in the hands of the classical state actors of international law. And that brings me to the rise of informal international lawmaking, which is maybe a bit of a strange term, but it basically is a concept that we defined to grasp the realities of certain normative dynamics which do not fit the classical boxes of public international law. Let me give you some examples. This country is a member of the OECD. You're doing a great job. In the OECD, you have a whole universe of all kinds of legal dynamics which you cannot capture in the classical categories of public international law. Think, for instance, of the activities of the Financial Action Task Force, the rules against money laundering. This doesn't fit the classical box. Think of the guidelines for multinational enterprises that were established by the OECD. But think of other things as well. The work of the International Organization for Standardization, the work of the Financial Stability Board, the all kinds of things such as the Proliferation Security Initiative, the Kimberley Scheme on conflict diamonds. Lots of examples of new rules that are increasingly important, but that are not created by the classical international diplomatic actors. So we defined this concept to grasp that complex reality. And we highlighted the fact that we see new forms of cooperation across the borders between public authorities and sometimes with the participation of private actors or international organizations. But what is typical of those activities is that they take place in a forum through a process that is different from the classical international legal fora, process informality. Or that the actors in those processes are not the classical diplomatic actors. That's what we call the actor informality. Or that the outcome may be different from a treaty, customary international law, and so on. Output informality. So three types of informality to show that this is something different, which you cannot simply put into one of the classical categories and boxes of public international law. You can wonder, why did this come up? How can we explain this? It has to do with a number of tendencies, and I'm going to go more deeply into it, but I first want to say something that is, in my view, related to this rise of informal international lawmaking. And that's a little bit stunning. But look at this graph. We studied the output of multilateral treaty making since the Second World War, basically, since we have the United Nations. So we looked at the number of multilateral treaties that are deposited with the United Nations Secretary General. And actually we saw that since the year 2000, more or less, we see a decline. Whereas the average was around 35 treaties per year, now it declined to 20. And between 2005 and 2010, only 9 new multilateral treaties were deposited. And in 2011, 2013, not a single. So we see something of a downward trend in the production of classical international law. Those who follow the work of the International Law Commission will also see that it is quite a while ago that the articles, the drafts of the International Law Commission were also translated in a real multilateral treaty. So something is going on with regard to the situation of traditional treaty making. And I try to capture that in my writings and try to understand how does this come. The world has become a more difficult place. We have much more multipolarity, as we say. Instead of the Cold War, bipolarity. Instead of the 1990s with their unipolarity, we are ever more in a situation of multipolarity. We have strong new emerging powers with sometimes very different normative preferences compared to the classical Western dominant states. But we also see different preferences. States, very often nowadays, don't like treaties anymore. They may say we have already enough treaty obligations. Talk with people in a treaty office of a foreign minister and they say, you know, we have so many treaties and we have to report on human rights treaties and so on and so forth. It's a big burden. And they are reluctant to adopt new treaty obligations. There is a new preference, which you see in many policy documents of countries. For instance, the United States Security Strategy of 2010 basically says, you know, we're going to prefer informal rather than traditional formal international commitments. So one is looking for creative new ways, governments, to do business together, but not through the classical treaty making. The treaty making is seen as too rigid. It's a long, difficult procedure. It requires a very formal ratification process. It takes a lot of time before treaties can enter into force. States can make reservations, and so on and so forth. And what is, of course, also true is that many of the existing multilateral treaties have their own kind of post-treaty life. This is what we call, in our own jargon, the dynamics of the COPs and the MOPs, the conferences of the parties and the meetings of the parties. A lot of law is being produced by those periodical meetings of treaty parties, a very fascinating area of global governance, a little bit understudied. So there are different policy preferences of state today, but there's something more that is explaining informal lawmaking and the decline of formal lawmaking. I think we are witnessing here the impact upon the law of the emergence of a transnational network and knowledge society. Instead of societies of individuals or societies of territorial states in international law, we are witnessing a transformation to a world of transnational networks. And those networks, you know, they don't care much about state boundaries. They transcend, they disaggregate the state. They're multiplying the types of actors and processes involved in cross-border cooperation. So the state is being supplemented, if you wish, corrected, challenged by a number of new actors. This can be government actors, regulatory agencies, national and international agencies, transnational corporations, even NGOs. But they are outside of the traditional framework of international law. In this increasingly complex society, you see also new technological and scientific needs. Just imagine how you can use traditional treaty and customary international law processes for regulating very specific, highly technical areas. Think of sanitary and phytosanitary standards and so on. We live in a very, very developed society and we need new normative processes to cope with that and to cooperate internationally in this respect. So, in my view, these factors, and there are still a number of other ones, I skip them now, they make for new forms of transnational cooperation that arise out of technological necessity. But it also shows that the new actors, those networks, those agencies, they are not classical actors of international law. They don't have treaty-making capacity. So the classical public international lawmaking is not available, is not appropriate. And so we are here in some kind of gray zone, which I think we need to come to terms with. I will come back to that issue, but I will now first say something about customary international law, which is a traditional topic of international lawmaking, and which has been with us for many, many centuries. It's historically the oldest source of international law, and I would say of law in general, but it also faces some consequences in light of globalization. Almost a decade ago, we saw writings about customary law being in trouble, or under attack from all sides, wrapped in mystery, increasingly obsolete, a mess. These are, as you can imagine, very often American authors who have been, you know, very tough on the classical discipline of customary international law. But it is true. that it is hard to think of customary international law as a very efficient way of regulating the needs of modern society in times of globalization. There are all kinds of problems with customary international law. It offers advantages. Customary law follows state practice. State practice can evolve quickly, so it can be flexible. It can be adjusting to new needs of society. It is responsive. But there are problems, because customary law very often lacks precision. And in our transnational network and knowledge societies, this is exactly what we need. We need precision. We cannot just cope with, you know, trial and error and something of ambiguous or ambivalent rules. We need precision. We need quickness. We need adaptiveness of the legal system. And in that sense, customary international law is still relevant. I think what Sir Michael Wood, the rapporteur of the International Law Commission, who has been working for many years now on a better way of, you know, a better methodology of establishing rules of customary international law, he has rightly pointed out to the fact that it remains necessary. There are gaps in international law, and you cannot do away with customary law. Not all countries are parties to all important multilateral treaties. You need to fill those gaps with customary international law. But it is not a substitute, and it cannot provide a sufficient answer to the needs of a modern globalizing international society. And that's why we need, again, informal lawmaking. And that's also what I think is so refreshing about a third notion, and so I come to my triangle, the notion of global governance. I'm a professor of international law at my university, but 10 years ago, we founded together with a number of other colleagues, economists, political scientists, historians, philosophers, a Center for Global Governance Studies, which is an interdisciplinary research center. And I'm a staunch believer in the need for more interdisciplinarity at universities to better capture and understand and analyze the complexities of both national and international developments. And in fact, we found out that bringing these various disciplinary perspectives together and enabled us to open up some of the traditional boxes, the kind of addicted patterns for the analysis in all the relevant sciences. Bringing sciences together gives you a much more open perspective. And as a legal scholar, I have benefited immensely from that. And I really believe it is important for lawyers, both when they are still in law school and also when they become scholars, when they become professionals, when they become practitioners. This, on the slide, gives you one of the many hundreds of definitions of the notion of global governance developed by a very famous scholar and friend, Professor Tom Weiss of the City University of New York. And you see in this definition that it is quite encompassing. It refers to a sum of laws, norms, policies, institutions that define and constitute transborder relations between states, but much more than states, intergovernmental, non-governmental organizations, even the market. In our capitalist world, markets themselves are institutions of global governance, whether we like it or not. So, I mean, you need to identify those actors. You need to identify all the different forms of normative activity that they produce, not just classical treaties, but also all kinds of rules which can even be private standards. It's very important, and I think a great contribution of the legal scholarship to international relations, that we are not just looking at public law, we take into account the incredible dynamics of private law. Many rules in international exchanges are not founded in public law, find their origins in contracts, all kinds of, you know, special rules, norms, elaborated often by private professional associations. I can give you many examples of that in many different areas. It's again showing you that we cannot capture the full international legal reality in the classical terms of public international law. So what I like about global governance, and I will stop here, is that it liberates us also from these two rigidly defined categories it opens up our legal horizon also to other interactions, other actors, other forms of normative activity, but also to the various interactions between the multiple layers of lawmaking. I come from a country, Belgium, which itself is a federal state and which has at least three different layers of lawmaking: local, the sub-state level, the federal level, but we are part of the European Union, and the European Union is another layer of lawmaking. And then you are still participating in another, more global layer of lawmaking. All of these layers interact with each other and create fascinating interactions and issues and challenges. And that kind of openness and that kind of dialogue between legal systems is something fascinating, which I think we ought to also convey to our legal students. I'm going to come to my conclusion, if I may. My main message is, let's try to bring in our teaching, in our scholarship, in our practice, public international law into the 21st century. Globalization has far-reaching implications also in the legal sphere. But I'm afraid to say that public international law, and maybe our law teaching and scholarship in general, has not yet sufficiently been able to adjust to these dynamics. I've given you the examples of the doctrine of the sources and of the subjects of public international law. If you look at that and you contrast it with the fascinating dynamics of informal international lawmaking and of global governance, it's just something that you feel you have to adjust. Now, that's my plea also. I think that public international law's limited responsiveness to these new dynamics generates a challenge. It creates a huge deficit in capturing all of the relevant transnational regulatory actors and regulatory processes. I think there is a need of bringing those different streams together, not excluding one to the other. It's not a matter of choice or. I think it's a matter of finding complementarity between the classical teachings of public international law and these new, more informal processes. But I think also we face a choice. As public international lawyers, we can basically say, okay, we're going to adapt, we're going to take the attitude of the ICJ in the reparation for injuries case, we're going to open up the system and recognize that there are dynamics and that international law has to follow the dynamics of international society, and then we gradually embrace those other normative processes. The other option is, of course, that we simply say, no, we don't like that. We stick to our turf, we continue to reason in terms of treaty law, customary international law, and so on. We stay what we are, we entrench ourselves, but then we have to be more modest. And then I think we have to just accept that public international law is not able to capture the full international legal dynamics anymore, that it is in a certain way just one part of a much broader international legal menu. But keep that in mind, because that means also that we will have to change our legal curricula and that we will have to take those other parts of the international legal menu better into account. Now, in any event, whether or not states like it, I think these new actors, these new regulatory processes and outputs, they will not go away. They will continue to play an increasingly important role. You see already in the case law of a number of domestic and international courts how those norms are being invoked, how slowly but surely practitioners, attorneys, magistrates, international organizations are trying to come to terms with those new dynamics. And I think that's a natural thing to happen. It may be very messy, it may be very uncertain, but the system is going to have to respond to these dynamics. I have just one concluding remark. I studied Greek, Latin, humanities in my young years, and I was always impressed by this saying, panta rei kai uden menai. Everything flows, nothing remains the same. If public international law wants to remain relevant for all of us, for students, for scholars, for practitioners, for professors, it will have to adapt itself continuously to the realities of globalization and international life. And a message for ourselves as well. For us too, this implies a constant need to adapt ourselves in our teachings, in our writings, and in our practice. Thank you very much.